the evil horde. Is there any other villainous group from the 80s that sends both shivers down your spine and anticipation in the toy aisle? When the Horde were released in the mid-80s, they were designed as a third faction that could fight both He-Man and Skeletor, and honestly, they were one of the coolest parts of the original Masters of the Universe line. And they kept going past the original releases, with additional members as the original Masters of the Universe line wound down, heading towards 1987 and the giant implosion of too much product. So today, if you haven't guessed, we are talking about Dragstor, not the Funko Pop version, although I'm a little surprised they made Funko of Dragstor because we were told the He-Man didn't sell that well. That's not important right now because we're talking about the classics figure here. So this was the final full year of, well, actually, no, I guess the next year was Mattel, but it was my last year running the brand, and I was determined to get all of the vintage figures as promised, and that meant updating Dragstor from his original release, including homages to his original action feature. Now, as I noted earlier, he was not part of the original release of the initial release of the Horde in the book that Tim Kilpin wrote, which showed the Horde as enemies of Skeletor and He-Man, and were then used by the girls group as a villain for She-Ra because he was available. So, with Secret Origins out of the way, new characters were added to the line in 86, 87, even though the line was sort of heading to its intimate demise. But Dragstor made it out, and, you know, not before the bitter end, when, you know, Megator had to ship to Europe, so he, you know, still made it to those U.S. shipping products. And, of course, getting him into classics in what would be the brown box, switching from the early white box because it was less expensive, and we were trying to save customers money and put it more into the toy. Now, the figure, the original figure, was more or less an action figure of the Road Ripper, meaning a vehicle that was done by a pull and rip system. So you can see even the concept art for Dragstor showed him like this. He continued to evolve, but he was always meant to be sort of a figure and vehicle in one, because, heck, Masters of the Universe was very vehicle-based, kind of like G.I. Joe and Star Wars and your mother's minivan. And converting him from an original figure into classics took sort of the usual Four Horsemen ingenious methods, because we knew what we had to work with, and it did require a lot of new parts, which is also why he didn't ship sort of till the tail end and fit into one of those sort of almost fully tooled slots. And as I noted, the Horsemen, of course, in their genius, did things like turning the ripcord into an axe that could be held as a weapon. I always loved when they took the action features and made them actually, you know, weapons or, you know, something of substance. Like when we gave She-Ra a comb knife. That was kind of weird. All right. So, Dragstor never appeared in the 2000X series, but he was quite popular, especially if your name was Val Staples and you run He-Man.org, and I did try to get him out as quick as I could because Val was a huge supporter of the line with his website and fan club and PowerCon, but we had to wait for a slot that was a mostly fully tooled figure, kind of like Ram Man. So, even though almost all of the Horde had already made it out, most of them had shared parts. I think he shared his arms and his hands, but that was, and maybe feet, that was about it. Because he needed new legs, he needed a new torso, so yeah, we had to put a lot of tooling into him. Now, like most of the figures in Classics, we couldn't do the action feature because that would have required a mechanical engineered chest that actually could allow the wheel, in this case, to spin. So we wanted to look at, you know, all the references for him, both from the original comic books, from the mini comics, from the card art, from posters, you know, as well as fan art. Like I've said many times, we looked at a lot of fan art in a way to judge how popular some characters were. A lot of times the more fan art there is, the more in demand a character is. It's a good way to sort of judge what fans are looking for. So, you know, hey, every little bit helps. The Classics figure was, like with most classics, it was a straight update without the action feature, but with an homage. In this case, the tire was embedded in his chest, but it didn't turn. But it was made of actual rubber, which I thought was really awesome. So, yeah, like the original toy that just had a, you know, spinner, this one felt like he actually had a tire, I guess, coming out of his chest. And that, I gotta say, that's something probably Terry did, because the Horsemen usually didn't specify materials, but when you had a designer like Bill or Terry on the line, they kind of always went the extra mile and found ways, you know, like giving Cerritus an earring and that kind of stuff made out of metal. So those are little features that Mattel designers did, not the Horsemen. The Horsemen sculpted him just out of resin and painted him, which is what they always do, and then Mattel comes along and tries to interpret their sculpt and make it actually into an articulated figure. And in this case, the choice to make the wheel made out of real rubber, so it had that textile feel. Toys are really tactile, and it's very important when holding a toy, you want to feel that tactile experience, which is why when you can use different materials, doesn't come up that much, it's really fun to do. And that was my favorite part of the figure, honestly, was the fact that the wheel had a rubbery, kind of squishy feel to it, and, you know, made it more than just a standard figure with, like, a black disc sticking out of his chest. So, while it's kind of ironic that Dragstor came to, kind of at the very end of Classics and at the end of the original Vintage line, you know, very much tried to actually mix this up from day one, like why Scareglow came out so early. Well, also because he needed so little tooling and he's popular. But, yeah, I didn't want to just release all of the, you know, the 87 figures at the tail end. And even though Dragstor couldn't recreate his action feature, you could have him in some cool poses. And, you know, he could still be like a vehicle rolling across your floor or through outer space or wherever your imagination takes you. And of course, like with all of the Horde, he got his crossbow, in this case, made to look like the grill or like the engine of a car there, which, you know, again, that's totally the Horseman, taking the vintage figure and giving it just that little plussed up love that merely makes it come to life, both through the accessories, through the articulation. And the Horde was now complete. Well, I guess Voltak still had to come out, but all of the figures were done. You know, we still had some Filmation characters that we were able to trickle out, but this marked the end of the Horde's transition into Classics. I mean, you know, doing the original versions that show up in all of the animation, well, I guess Mosquitor showed up here, but yeah, Dragstor definitely did not. And, you know, he tends to get left off a lot. He's not exactly, maybe he's just not as photogenic. I don't know. But it's rare to find a group shot of the Horde that includes Dragstor in it. He's just kind of one of those late shipping figures that, while some people, he was very special, like, as I said, Val Staples, who ran He-Man.org, loved this figure. I would say we didn't get that many requests for him. He's kind of an oddball. But you know what? He's cool. And he's out, and he completed the Horde, and he helped complete getting all the vintage figures. And that's what really mattered, because we made that promise, and it really made me happy that we fulfilled it.